Wir wollen heute über die iranische Zivilgesellschaft sprechen und vor allem darüber diskutieren, ob und inwiefern das Atomabkommen vom letzten Jahr die Handlungsspielräume für Aktivistinnen und Aktivisten, Kulturschaffende im Iran vergrößert hat oder vielleicht auch nicht. Mein Name ist Bauke Baumann und ich bin Referent für Nahost und Nordafrika hier in der Böll-Stiftung und unter anderem auch für das Iran-Programm zuständig. Seit dem Abschluss des Atomabkommens im Juli 2015, also vor gut einem Jahr, haben sich die Beziehungen zwischen Iran und dem Westen drastisch verändert und intensiviert. Heute fahren deutsche Minister und Wirtschaftsdelegationen regelmäßig nach Teheran. Es werden neue Kooperationen eingegangen und Geschäfte abgeschlossen. Iran öffnet sich nach außen, wenn auch nur graduell und gegen innere Widerstände. Was aber passiert im Iran selbst? Darüber wissen wir hier in Deutschland, finde ich, immer noch recht wenig. Viele nehmen einfach an, dass die Öffnung nach außen über kurz oder lang auch mit einer Öffnung nach innen, also einer Liberalisierung, einhergehen wird. Ob das tatsächlich so ist, bezweifle ich allerdings, zumindest nicht zwingend. Man denke nur an China. Bislang jedenfalls hat die Regierung von Präsident Rouhani ihre innenpolitischen Reformversprechen nicht umsetzen können oder wollen. Wir wollen uns heute daher genauer anschauen, wie sich die Situation der Zivilgesellschaft im Iran darstellt, welche Erwartungen, aber auch Befürchtungen sie an die wirtschaftliche und politische Annäherung zwischen Iran und dem Westen knüpft und natürlich inwiefern Europa zivilgesellschaftliche Akteure im Iran praktisch und sinnvoll unterstützen kann. Ich freue mich auf die Diskussion und ich freue mich vor allem auf unsere Gäste, die teilweise sehr weit hierher gereist sind. Und ich möchte nun übergeben an den Moderator des heutigen Abends, an Dr. Ali Fatollah Nejad. Ali ist Associate Fellow der Deutschen Gesellschaft für Auswärtige Politik, der DGAP, und außerdem auch wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter am Center of International Cooperation and Development Research der Universität Brüssel. Ali hat diese Veranstaltung gemeinsam mit uns konzipiert und organisiert. Dafür möchte ich ihm nochmal ganz herzlich danken. Und nun wünsche ich uns allen eine spannende Diskussion.
Einen schönen guten Abend. Schön, dass ihr alle hier seid, trotz des schlechten Wetters. Thank you very much to the Heinrich Böll Foundation for facilitating this event. I'm going to now switch into English as a matter of courtesy to our guests tonight. So I'm really honored to be here and to have the opportunity to discuss with all of you quite an important topic relating to Western-Iranian relations. And the topic of tonight going to be somehow connected to something that was organized here last week in terms of Western relations to Cairo, to the regime of al-Sisi. And so the leading question will be actually to look in how far Western-Iranian relations will have, what kind of impact they're going to have actually in terms of domestic politics and how the evolution can be analyzed in the domestic sphere. So as a short introduction in terms of the content that we're going to address tonight, if you look at the situation of Iranian civil society, you've seen that during the past decades, so during the much of the 2000s, it has been under huge pressure, because not only was there was a repressive state which was making things difficult for Iranian civil society anyways, but then there was also a lot of external pressure from the Bush-Cheney administration back then that also impacted upon the space available to civil society. So basically what has happened, and I've been writing about the subject for the last decade, is that Iranian civil society got really under, in a state of siege, basically, between between not only the authoritarian state, but also by more or less imperial pressure that we had back then. But now we've probably entered a new phase with the election of President Rouhani in 2013. And arguably, and this is perhaps also you know, open to discussion, but I would argue that we see now a new era where we don't have the era of regime change anymore. So perhaps, and then we're going to have, you know, we have a revitalization of economic, political, and strategic relations with the Islamic Republic of Iran. And the question is how the space available to Iranian civil society and activism, you know, is going to look like, you know, in the context of this process of rapprochement between the West and Iran. So this is more or less, you know, the leading question for tonight's discussion, to see how in this new era, you know, Iran civil society is being affected. To discuss all that, I'm delighted to have actually three panelists, but so let me start explaining where Omid is. Omid Nuripur, who needs probably no introduction in this foundation, who is obviously the spokesperson, foreign policy spokesperson of the Green Party in Germany, but there has been a special parliamentary session on the Syria mandate that is actually going to start right now in the German Bundestag, so probably going to be, I mean, he's going to join us, but I reckon that they're going to be quite late. And I understand that, you know, Syria is nothing that is less important than Iran. So in any case, so let me briefly tell you how we're going to proceed tonight. We're going to have, you know, by our presenters, two short speeches, around 10 or 15 minutes each. And Hadi gonna commence, and Ziba gonna take over, and then, you know, we're gonna have a small discussion here before we open to the Q&A to the public. So for those who did not hear that, actually there is a second floor. So for those of you who want to sit down, but there's no translation in the other room, so. That's the situation. So let us start. Let me first introduce to you Dr. Hadi Rahimi, who is the executive director of the International Campaign for Human Rights in Iran that is based in New York City. And the International Campaign for Human Rights in Iran has arguably published the most substantive reports on the state of Iranian civil society. Against the backdrop of this process of rapprochement, the hopes that they had and the expectations that many, you know, actors from various, you know, various quarters of Iran civil society have had. So I would, you know, recommend every one of you to look at those very amazing reports that they do publish on a regular basis. I'm more than delighted that Hadi accepted our invitation to come to New York City. And I'm going to introduce Ziba later on. So first, I'm going to give over to Hadi.
Thank you, Ali. And thank you all for being here on such a cold evening. I imagine Berlin evenings are often cold at this time of the year. And thanks to the foundation for organizing this event and having us to speak to you tonight. I'm going to talk very briefly about the state of affairs with regard to the Iranian civil society at the moment, and then we'll have a discussion of what does it mean with regard to the rapprochement that's taking place or has the potential to take place between Iran and the West. To tell you where things stand at the moment inside Iran with regard to civil society, I have to take you back a little bit to a critical junction, which is June of 2009, and tell you where we were before that, what happened after that, and therefore where we are now. Very quickly, between 1997, when a reformist president, Mohammad Khatami, came to power, all the way up to June of 2009, Iranian civil society, relative to before 1997, flourished. And various independent organizations, movements, campaigns were organized, and even though they were repressed from day one, but they had a space to exist. In June 2009, as many of you know, there was an election in Iran that led to a large contest between the competing candidates and resulted in large protests that were known as the Green Movement. To me, that was a pivotal moment for the civil society because we saw almost a complete uprooting of civil society from June 2009 and the following months. What that meant was that every independent organization and association that had flourished during the previous decades was uprooted. They were literally locked up their buildings. The activists and people and their staff were imprisoned, or they had been chased out of the country. So by 2010, the entire body of civil society was disseminated. A large number of activists were in prison, serving long-term sentences. A good portion of them had to flee the country to go into exile, as much as 30 to 40% of activists. And the few who remained were silenced one way or another. Therefore, between 2009 and 2013, civil society had completely been absent from the equation of domestic affairs in Iran inside the country. Then comes June of 2013, when Rouhani becomes a candidate. During his presidential candidate, Rouhani understood that the attacks on civil society and generally the confrontation between the state and the Green Movement was something that he had to address. And indeed, in his promises during campaigning, he made two major promises, one on foreign policy, one on domestic policy. On domestic policy, he promised to restore the liberties that had been lost, to bring back a semblance of life to civil society. And of course, on foreign policy, he talked about the nuclear negotiations. Now, many in the West think that his mandate was primarily the nuclear negotiations. But within the country, people understood that as important as the nuclear negotiation is the restoration of the liberties that had been lost. And what he himself called it, he said, it is time to end the security state. The security state meant what had happened after 2009, when independent media, journalists, freedom of expression, freedom of association, anything you can imagine had been uprooted. That promise of Rouhani, of course, once he got elected, got overshadowed more or less with the nuclear negotiations that got underway. What is important is that civil society activists in Iran and outside Iran, the one who had left, supported the focus on the nuclear negotiations. And those are the reports that Ali mentioned. We did very in-depth reporting, bringing the voices of Iranian civil society to the outside, where they very much were supporting the negotiations. They were very much against any military action. I don't know if you would recall, summer of 2011 was a time when it looked like US and Israel were gearing up to attack Iran. And Iranian civil society very much opposed that military option, supported the negotiations, and the fact that Europe and US were talking to Iran to reach an agreement. However, the understanding of civil society was that once we put the nuclear issue behind us, Rouhani's focus would turn to domestic affairs. That was the hope. However, in reality, we see that has not happened. Indeed, Rouhani has been a very weak president, in my opinion, with regard to domestic affairs. I cannot point to any major or anything of substance in terms of policy, legislation, executive order that he has initiated and backed to bring change after 3.5 years in power. So to talk about where we stand with regard to civil society today, I just want to refer to what Rouhani himself said just 2 days ago. He gave a major speech that got a lot of attention inside Iran, and he very forcefully attacked the repression of media and the fact that there is no independent media in the country. And he said that security does not come only with guns. We do need a free press. The fact that 3.5 years into his presidency, he still has to battle for any kind of critical media to exist, that to me indicates his failure to have reached any progress on that front. So now I'm just going to tell you about the various aspects of civil society and where they stand. Rohan's reference to free media perhaps came with regard to a big controversy happening inside Iran, with regard to an editor-in-chief who is in jail, sitting right now in solitary confinement. He's not a political writer, he's not a social activist, he is an architect who was running the most prominent architectural website in the country. And what he did about a month ago, he was leaked a letter from inside of Tehran mayoralty where it showed that the Tehran mayor was handing out land and buildings like candy cheaply to members of Tehran City Council. It was an example of corruption being brought to light. Of course, people who were involved in corruption haven't paid a price, but the security intelligence forces have detained the editor. He sits in a solitary cell right now. And that gives you an idea where we are with regard to freedom of journalism and the press. People, the censorship is so high that you can't write on political and social, major social issues. And even if you talk about corruption and very local issues, you're endangered. With regard to freedom of expression and activism in general, as I mentioned, much of the activist community has been disassembled, meaning that they're either in exile, in jail, or silenced. Right now, there is a large number of them in prison, and probably the most prominent example you should be aware of, someone who has very bravely been active on women's rights, promoting human rights, and campaigning against the death penalty, is right now in jail by the name of Narges Mohammadi. She has been handed a 16-year prison sentence, even though she's gravely ill. That is an example of where the activists who did not silence themselves and were willing to speak out once Rouhani came to power. And they didn't. She didn't do anything major that would have threatened the state. After Rouhani, she was hopeful that she can go back to doing something meaningful, and death penalty is a major issue in Iran. Iran executes more people than any other country on per capita basis, and this has been going on 10, 15 years now. And there are people who get prison sentences simply for a Facebook posting or social networking posting. The average sentence, we're doing a study, a very systematic study of the average sentences that the judiciary hands out to activists. We're comparing before 2013 to after 2013. And we're finding that the sentences on average actually have doubled compared to pre-Rouhani. It used to be 2 to 5 years was the kind of sentences activists would get for exercising their freedom of expression. Today, they are 7 to 12 years. It's much more draconian. And with regard to freedom of association, I mentioned that all independent organizations were shuttered. When Rouhani came to power, he gave the signal that he's going to allow some of these associations, which are very important for foundation of civil society, to come back and open up. And the one we were hoping most and foremost was the oldest association of them, the Association of Journalists, something that has been in the country for decades, going back before revolution, and something that existed during the Islamic Republic, and 2009 it was shuttered completely. Even that organization has not gained permit to come back as a professional organization, let alone labor unions, let alone human rights organizations, and let alone women's rights campaigns, which existed before 2009. Finally, I have to mention the issue of judiciary in Iran and its lack of independence, and particularly with regard to the community of lawyers. Again, from 1997, there was a group of lawyers who very bravely chose to represent prisoners of conscience, or people who were prosecuted for exercising their basic freedoms. The most well-known of it is Center for Human Rights Defenders, established by Shirin Ebadi, who brought her to the international limelight. Those lawyers right now, none of them can exercise their legal profession. Basically, what has happened since 2009, a number of them themselves were put in jail for being a lawyer to a prisoner of conscience. The most famous one is Abdul Fattah Soltani, who sits in jail today, serving a 13-year prison sentence. And his only crime is for representing defendants as a lawyer. That also has meant that intelligence forces completely dominate the judiciary. a judge issues a sentence that the interrogators have already told the prisoner. We have many, many cases documented where the prisoner was told during interrogation, either you will cooperate with me, meaning the interrogator, or you will get 4-year sentence, 6-year sentence. I'll make sure you're behind bars for that long. Lo and behold, when the defendant goes in front of the judge gives exactly that sentence. So we don't see any independence of judiciary here. And even most troubling, by now the judiciary has decided for cases of prisoners of conscience, they cannot choose a lawyer. They have to choose from a list that is approved by the judiciary ahead of time. And it is a catch-22, if you know what I mean. That list does not exist. Anyone who's gone and said, okay, I can't get my own lawyer, tell me who can I have represent me, that list yet doesn't exist. Finally, I want to mention, it looks like the intelligence security forces have run out of targets in terms of political activists, social activists, rights activists, and we have seen since 2013 a trend of targeting artists and cultural figures. More and more musicians, filmmakers, writers are being prosecuted, put in jail, or forced into exile. That's a very troubling development. I just probably running out of time. Okay, so let me talk about some bright spots, whereas we don't see the traditional civil society taking root or being able to operate inside the country in the conventional sense. I do see the fact that internet and social networks have grown tremendously inside Iran. That is providing a platform for the young population of Iran. I would call the internet as the emerging public square in Iran. Indeed, the amount of engagement on the social networks, both the ones that are banned, like Twitter and Facebook, and the ones that are allowed, like there is a app, I don't know if it's, I think in Germany it's known, in the US nobody knows it or uses it, called Telegram. And we track the interaction from inside Iran with our own Facebook page, Twitter account, Telegram channel. And I'm amazed by the extent of interaction that goes on in there, the numbers involved. And this is an environment where getting on Facebook is not allowed. You can't do it. You have to go around, get a lot of different technical abilities like VPNs to get on there. But it does look like most of the people go through that trouble to reach social networks. And we have seen actually developments on civil society organized on social networks. Just, I believe it was last week, an event happened, we can't quite call it a social activism, but there was the birthday of the first king of the first Persian Empire, who is buried in the famous Persepolis. Somehow, organizers managed to get 20, 30, maybe 40,000 people show up in that spot, which is not a city. You have to travel from the main city there an hour to get there. And I think everyone was shocked, more than anyone, the intelligence security services, who think that they have everything under control. There was a very good analysis on one of the websites close to intelligence services talking about how did we get caught? Where were we? How did we, you know, how did we get surprised? Why nobody noticed this? And that happened over social networks. No one can quite figure out how and why there was no indication of it. But I saw in the news today that they are actually going through the travel logs of airline tickets to see who flew on that day from other cities to the city of Shiraz, which is the place you would fly to drive to that location. So that shows you how seriously they're taking this. There has been many other social events organized, but in terms of more traditional civil society, I do see there is a very strong interest in environmental issues in different parts of the country. Actually, one of the biggest and most important plights facing Iran is environmental disaster, water, land erosion, air quality. And I'm seeing there is a lot of keen interest among citizens to organize around these issues as much as they can. Corruption is another one. I just mentioned the big controversy in Tehran regarding corruption in the city council. But also over the past few months, we've seen something that we really never seen, which is the leak of documents from inside the state administration. Again, over social networks, someone leaked a few months ago the salary pay stubs, payments, monthly payments to some senior government officials, which showed the astronomical salaries they were receiving, which was not congruent at all with their position. That, again, caused a lot of controversy, and in a way, civil society pushed back to the point where several of those officials resigned. I was very impressed by that. We don't have much of a culture of leaking information from inside the government to the outside. And then there are local issues that people have been organizing on social networks, even things that we wouldn't think would catch fire in Iran, such as animal rights. I've seen several campaigns for animal rights where there's been cruelty documented, brought to public attention. There has been large reaction to it. So I think we will see a new kind of civil society emerge in Iran. Definitely the social, economic, political issues that the country faces require that citizen input. The government is not going to be able to put a lid on it. But hopefully in the rest of the session, we can talk about what does it all mean for the Iranian civil society when the West, particularly Europe, is moving closer to the Islamic Republic, establishing economic, political ties, and how can that rapprochement more of a do good than do harm? I think that is the challenge facing Europe right now, how they can do more good in Iran than harm with regard to where we stand.
Thank you so much, Hadi. Thank you. For laying out the continuity of repression or the difficulties that Iranian civil society is facing. Omid, thank you for joining us on the panel. I'm going to introduce him in a few minutes, but next we're going to we have the pleasure to listen to Dr. Ziba Mir Hosseini, who is one of the world famous legal anthropologists on feminism and women's rights in Islamic majority countries. She's a professorial research associate at the Center of Middle Eastern and Islamic Law at SOAS, my alma mater, at the School of Oriental and African Studies in London. And she's also a founding member of Musawa, a global movement for equality in Muslim family laws. And next year, she's going to be a visiting professor at NYU at New York University. She was recently the lead editor of two books. One is called Gender and Equality in Muslim Family Law, published with Ivy Torres's paperback edition, going to be out this month, I think. And secondly, she was also the co-lead editor of another book published early 2015 by One World, Men in Charge, Rethinking Authority in Muslim Legal Tradition. Ziba, thank you very much for joining us this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, and it's a pleasure to be here. And coming to Berlin to Heinrich Böll really reminded me, resonated of a meeting in this place in 2000. And that was immediately after the parliamentary election, when the reformists had the majority. As Omid said, in 1997, Khatami came to office, but never came to power, and basically, the civil society and the reform movement found a voice in the structure. And in February, in November this year, 2016, that is exactly 3 years after the election of Hassan Rouhani in 2013, we had another parliamentary election. And this parliamentary election, actually, the role that women and civil society played Despite all this restriction and the willingness of Iranians to take part in elections really is amazing and is changing. So I agree with whatever Hadi said, and thank him for giving us this background to the current state of civil society. But what I want to do is actually frame this in a wider thing. First of all, why the Iranian securities have become so irrational and so fearful, okay? And also address the question of Iranian civil society being under siege. And I would say that it has been under siege, but the siege changes those who are occupying the forces. So I think to understand this, we need to understand three things. The tension between the very idea of what is an Islamic Republic, between the Republican side of the state and the Islamic side of the state. The Republican is represented by the parliament and by the president and chosen by popular vote. And the Islamic side is in the institution of Velayat-e Faqih, or jurist or ruling jurist. And in fact, what has happened, because the very idea of Islamic Republic has no precedence in the history of Iran or in Islamic history. It is very new and it was unknown. But now after 37 years, it's very clear what it is. And what we know is how it evolved is that the Republican side of the state is under the tight control of the Islamic side of the state through the institution and organization. So the tension is built. But at the same time, the Islamic or theocratic side of the state cannot do with the without the Republican side, because popular vote is extremely important, and the entire legitimacy of the system rests on people's choice. And so whoever becomes a president comes into confrontation with the supreme leader. So that is part of it. To me, that opens space for activism, space for change, and it is a catalyst for change. And the second is the factional politics. And this factional politics is constantly has been evolving. In 1980s, this factional policy politics was only between the Islamic right and Islamic left. And also we need to understand this factional politics within the global context. Because in 1980s, shortly after the revolution, it was the invasion of Iraq that really changed the balance of power in the interest to the benefit of the Islamic and radical Islamism. And after the end of the war, and after that Ayatollah Khomeini died, there was an opening, a relative opening with the two terms of presidency of Ayatollah Rafsanjani. And that two terms of opening led to the unexpected election of Khatami in 1997. So in 1997, what we see the popular will coming up. We see a shift towards the Republican side. But that, from that moment, what we see in Iran is a dual state. There is a struggle and a fight between the Republican side and also with the theocratic side. And at the end, by the second term of the Khatami's election, because the judiciary is in absolute hand and control of the theocratic side, the head of the judiciary is appointed by the supreme leader, and it's only accountable to him. And then by gradually after 1992, the left faction, the Islamic left faction, was gradually put aside both from the judiciary and from the parliament and also judiciary and parliament, basically, and government as well. And then when Roha and Khatami came, reformists came to power. And it was for the first time, you know, the idea of civil society in Iran, the debates about civil society was there in 1997. And he came on a promise of rule of law, democracy, and civil society. Of course, he did not manage to fulfill his promises, the same way as Rouhani has not. But he has opened the space, and those 8 years changed the entire discourse. And when we look at the women's movement, you know, it is then that we really see the emergence of what is now known as a women's movement. It happened during those years of Khatami. Before that, there were 47 women's organizations, and by the end of it, there were 600. So there is an opening, there is an activism, there is a relative press and new discourses. But all this comes to an abrupt end in 2005 with the election of Ahmadinejad. And one thing that made it possible, this abrupt change, was invasion of Iraq and 9/11, and President Bush putting Iran under the axis of evil. That really weakened the hand of reformists. And the ultra-conservatives in Iran, like the conservatives elsewhere, need an outside enemy. Without outside enemy, they cannot exist. And President Bush gave that outside enemy. And at the same time, the fact that Khatami could not fulfill his election promises created a situation that both the women's movement and students really turned back. And as a result, somebody like Ahmadinejad came, who was an unknown entity. And his election in 2005 was actually a shock to Iranian civil society. And I think it was also a very good lesson, in a sense that during that period, we see a reconciliation between the secular women's movement and the religious women's movement, because they realized that, you know, it is not... they realize that, you know, they have the same goal and they need to come together. And I think that is a big realization. And some of the Iranian activists outside Iran and Iranian opposition also came to that realization. And I also think 2001 and the aftermath of it, the war on terror, was also a wake-up call for many people, because both the Iranian progressive forces, Iranian civil society realized that they are actually in the same boat. And I think the European and Western progressive forces realized that they are in the same boat. So that that global politics is very important. And now with the election of Rouhani is not a reformist. He is a centrist, he's a guy from inside. But as he's a president, he came with a number of promises. His electoral campaign symbol was a key, which basically was a key of opening the locked door behind the Republican side. And also a key of ending the house arrest of the three leaders of the Green Movement, that is the movement, that the civil rights movement that started after 2009 presidential election. He hasn't been able to fulfill this. But he had relative success, in the sense of for me, one of the relative successes was the reopening of Zanon magazine, which was the first magazine, feminist magazine, but at the same time working within an Islamic framework, that came out in 1992. And that was really a beginning. It was the sister magazine of Kian, which was the intellectual reformist, But also it was the first platform, the first voice that we had in Iran through the movement that was independent from the had an independent voice from the political party, and also was feminist and had no qualm to call itself feminist, but at the same time were Muslims and were proud of Islamic identity as well, and had a different understanding of Islam and did not see Islam as a source of oppression, but understanding of Islam, the way that Islam, like any religion, can be used. And I must say, human rights can be used for that. Any huge or any big idea, ideology, or ethos can be used for something contrary to that. So this is basically the context that it is. But what has happened, it's true that civil society has been absolutely silenced in 2009. And it is since 2013 that gradually some of them come out. And one of the first groups that was organized after Rouhani's election is Kanun Shahrvandi, women's citizenship rights. And that is important. And also women played a role in, as well as the students' movement during the election. They are under constraint. And civil society in Iran, as Hadi said, is very unconventional. It cannot really be compared with others. And there is more and less no women's NGOs now after 2009. But their ideas have gone deep down into the society. And it has become grassroots. And it is really paradoxical. The more the state tries to control, the more dissent comes from inside. So I would say that Iranian civil society, comparing with what happened in 2009, population in this building is much more secular orientated, much more educated, much more tolerant, and more accepting of pluralism, and also for democratic change. And at the very end, I think there is a limit that the state and authoritarian systems can continue without legitimacy. The legitimacy from below is very important. And what is happening now in Iran is that people are refusing granting that legitimacy. So I would say that a new era of politics in Iran is about to begin, but it's not easy. And now the campaign is already started for another election in Iran, June 2017, presidential election. And that is exactly why Rouhani the other day said that thing. That is exactly why Rouhani now would come in defense of movement. Why? Because it is election time. And each time, you know, moves little by little. It's a long road, and I'm afraid there's no other way than this long road. But I end with this. There is a tacit alliance between Iranian ultra-conservatives, hardliners, and the European, the American, and the global hardliners. They actually have the same goal. They want war. They want interest, money. And they want to sell arms. And what is happening in the region, the regional politics, is actually extremely important. So what has happened after the nuclear agreement is actually the regional politics have become much more aggressive. And it's a reaction to that. So it is a very interesting night, because tonight is the election night. So what if Trump wins? Then, you know, we need to have a different kind of discussion. Thank you.
(Clears throat) Thank you very much, Ziba, for all those interesting points. And so we're going to have a lot of things to be discussed. But first, before we do that, I'm going to give the mic to Omid Nuripur, who doesn't need any introduction in this foundation anyways, and probably not also in Germany. He's one of the most prominent German foreign policy makers. And he has also been traveling to Iran with the foreign minister in the last few years since the presidency of Rouhani. And I'm looking forward to hearing his 10 minutes, 15 minutes.
Okay, I'm going to speak German. The reason for that is this is one of the toughest languages on earth to learn, and I cannot miss any opportunity to show that I somehow made it. Ich möchte mich entschuldigen, dass ich zu spät komme. Die Koalition zerlegt sich gerade an der Frage Mandat Syrien, Counter Daesh. Und deshalb konnte ich einfach nicht weg. Und ich musste dann irgendwann mal weg. Und Kollegen haben für mich im Ausschuss übernommen. Die haben sich immer noch nicht geeinigt. Ich freue mich sehr heimlich. Ich habe 2008 das erste Mal nach 20 Jahren den Iran besucht, war auf einer Reformerkonferenz tagsüber und nachts habe ich Leute getroffen unter sehr widrigen Umständen, viele von denen sind namentlich auch bekannt. Und wir hatten eine sehr lange Diskussion, die ich nicht vergessen kann, mit zwei Aktivistinnen, zwei Rechtsanwältinnen. Ich sage jetzt auch nicht, worüber sie gearbeitet haben, dann wissen viele auch hier, wer das sind, das schadet denen eher. Ganz am Ende von diesem unglaublich beeindruckenden Gespräch fragte ich sie, was ist ihre größte Befürchtung? Die Antwort war, unsere größte Befürchtung ist, es gibt ein Nuklearabkommen. Ihr schließt dann quasi die Akte Aufmerksamkeit für den Iran, so wie ihr es mit Gaddafi und seinen Chemiewaffen gemacht habt und lasst uns dann alleine mit der Situation hier und mit den Menschenrechten. Ich glaube, das sagt ganz viel aus über unsere Hausaufgaben, die wir jetzt haben, nachdem es ein Abkommen gegeben hat. Rouhani hat viele spannende Sachen gesagt in diesen Tagen zum Thema Wahlkampf. Gestern hat er gesagt, wir brauchen dringend mehr Pressefreiheit. In so ziemlich jedem Land auf der Welt würde man sagen, du bist der Präsident, mach doch einfach. Im Iran ist der Wahlkampf besonders intensiv. Wir haben jetzt ein Atomabkommen. Ich will ein paar Takte zum Atomabkommen sagen. Ich habe das richtig gefunden. Ich finde immer noch, dass es richtig ist, dass es ein Atomabkommen gibt. Aber ich fand das richtig, weil es eine einfache Lösung und eine einfache Formel gibt. Die Formel lautet, wenn es kein Abkommen gibt, gibt es keine Inspektionen. Ohne Inspektionen wäre das der schnellste Weg für den Iran zur Bombe. Wenn ich die Wahl habe zwischen zwei schlechten Lösungen, nehme ich die ohne eine Atombombe. Das Problem ist nur, dass nach dem Abkommen unser Außenminister, der deutsche Außenminister, von den Verhandlungen zurückkam und wortwörtlich sagte, nun werden wir die Dynamik dieser erfolgreichen Verhandlungen nutzen, um das Problem in Syrien zu beheben. Und ich habe dann mich am Kopf gekratzt und gefragt, ob er denn weiß, was er da tut. Es ist offenkundig, dass Iran durch das Atomabkommen sehr viel Geld bekommt. Sehr viel Geld auch, was dem Iran zusteht, historisch und rechtlich. Es ist offenkundig, dass sie mit dem Geld vieles machen, was gut ist. Die Modernisierung der zivilen Luftfahrtflotte ist überfällig gewesen und die kommt jetzt relativ schnell voran. Eine Stimulation für die Wirtschaft, Schaffen von Arbeitsplätzen, das machen sie, aber die machen nicht nur das, sondern das sind noch zwei andere Bereiche. Das eine ist, seit 2009 und nach all dem, nachdem auch da quasi jegliche Schleuse geschlossen worden ist nach den gefälschten Wahlen, ist es offenkundig, dass das Repressionssystem und die Maschinerie deutlich mehr Geld kostet, weil man einfach deutlich mehr schaut, deutlich weniger zulässt, deutlich mehr die Repressionsschrauben angezogen hat. Das Zweite, das ist fast noch grausamer, ist natürlich die Kriegskasse für die Regionalpolitik. Und ich teile 100%, was gesagt worden ist, die ist hyperaggressiv. Mein Eindruck ist, dass es sowas gibt wie eine Arbeitsteilung mittlerweile innerhalb eines hochfragmentierten Regimes, dass es Leute gibt wie Qasem Soleimani, die machen das da draußen und dafür lassen sie ein paar Leute im Land selbst machen oder lassen zum Beispiel Zarif bei den Atomverhandlungen dann halbwegs in Frieden und dafür lässt Zarif die in Frieden. Es gibt ein Tabu historisch im Iran, es ist riesig. Das ist die Frage von Stationierung ausländischer Streitkräfte im Iran. Darüber sind Regierungen gestürzt, da gibt es viele Mythen, Legenden. Das ist ein Riesenthema im Iran. Vor wenigen Wochen haben die Russen erklärt, wir werden jetzt unsere Angriffe auf Aleppo über Hamadan fliegen, eine Luftwaffenbasis im Westen des Landes. Zarif war in diesem Augenblick in Norwegen. Da hatte seine Konsultationen mit seinem Kollegen beendet und die waren zusammen auf dem Weg zur Pressekonferenz. Zarif hat diese Nachricht erreicht. Daraufhin hat er gesagt, geh du zur Pressekonferenz. Er ist ins Auto gestiegen, ist zum Flughafen, damit er zurückfliegt. Ich behaupte, weil er gar nicht wusste, was er da sagen soll. Er hat sich 3 Tage dazu nicht geäußert. Den ersten Tag hat sich gar niemand im Iran geäußert. Abends hat dann der Parlamentspräsident gesagt, stimmt nicht. Ja doch, das stimmt. Die Russen haben das gemacht. Dann hat jemand gesagt, aber es wird nicht nochmal passieren. Daraufhin haben die Russen gesagt, klar, machen wir weiter. Dann gab es wieder Konsultationen. Ich sage das auch, weil es ein Stückchen zeigt, diese Geschichte, das ist jetzt nicht über den Iran, über Syrien, die Opposition ist so zerstritten und der Assad-Block ist einheitlich, ist einfach nicht wahr. Es gibt riesige Friktionen zum Beispiel zwischen Iran und den Russen. Aber es ist auch offenkundig, dass die Russen jetzt anscheinend im Iran machen dürfen, die seit sehr, sehr langer Zeit niemand gemacht hat. Einer der Gründe für die iranische Revolution 57 ist falsch, das heißt 79 war ja auch, dass zum Beispiel in der Bevölkerung es eine Stimmung gab, dass es zu viele amerikanische Militärberater gibt, damals 40.000, jetzt gibt es Russen im Land und das führt zu tumultartigen Szenen innerhalb des Regimes plötzlich. Also kein Parlamentarier kann nochmal in den Wahlkreis, wenn er nicht wenigstens einmal aufsteht und sagt, das will ich falsch. Wie gesagt, es gibt eine traumatische Geschichte von Besetzung und so weiter und so fort, durch zum Beispiel eben auch von russischen Soldatinnen und Soldaten. Das Atomabkommen bringt aber, wie gesagt, auch ein anderes Geld rein. Ich glaube, dass wir dennoch nüchtern bleiben müssen. Genauso wie die Iraner in mindestens 3 Ländern in der Region eine fürchterliche Rolle spielen. Das ist aus meiner Sicht Libanon, Syrien und teilweise im Irak. Mit ihrer gegenseitigen Paranoia mit Saudi-Arabien, deren Ideologie sicher deutlich aggressiver ist, so viele Brände setzen in viele Länder der Region, muss man natürlich sehr nüchtern sich anschauen, wie wir jetzt da mit dieser neuen Situation umgehen. Und ja, es gibt sehr viele Projektionen von Erwartungen, es gibt sehr viele Sehnsüchte. Es gibt im Iran, oder jetzt nicht mehr, aber es gab die Erwartung, jetzt sind die Sanktionen, werden die Sanktionen sofort aufgehoben und es gibt sofort einen wirtschaftlichen Aufschwung und sofort kommen jetzt die ausländischen Investoren und so weiter und so fort. Diese Erwartung ist ja auch teilweise geschürt worden von denjenigen, die verhandelt haben. Das ist nicht aus dem Nichts gekommen. Zeigt aber auch ein Stückchen, wie groß die Sehnsucht ist, endlich aus dem Schatten rauszukommen und auf die Plattform, auf die internationale Plattform zu treten und den Austausch zu suchen. Deshalb sind ja manche Reisen, es gibt Leute, die reisen, höre ich, in den Iran und treffen dann die Studierende und gehen mit denen dann durch die Straßen und unterhalten sich mit denen. Das ist super wichtig, nicht nur für die deutsche Gesellschaft oder für die westlichen Gesellschaften, um einen Eindruck zu bekommen, was dort passiert. Das ist eine unglaubliche Ermutigung für die Leute vor Ort, dass sie nicht alleine gelassen werden. Aber zentral ist, dass man vergisst, um es jetzt mal formalistisch zu formulieren, es gab 3 Sorten von Sanktionen. Die erste Sanktionsform war die wegen des Atomprogramms des Irans. Die zweite war oder ist wegen der Unterstützung terroristischer Gruppierungen und bewaffneter Gruppen. Und die dritte Stufe ist, die dritte Art von Sanktionen ist wegen der Menschenrechtssituation. Und es ist höchste Zeit, dass wir lauter über diese letzten beiden, vor allem aus meiner Sicht über die letzte Variante auch sprechen. Wenn man jetzt die Iraner auf irgendwelchen internationalen Konferenzen trifft, es kommt ja jedes Jahr einer zum Beispiel zu dieser lustigen Münchner Sicherheitskonferenz und sie fragt, wie wollt ihr denn eigentlich die Sanktionen aufheben? Einfach ganz, ganz naiv gefragt, ist die Antwort, nein, wir müssen ja erstmal die anderen. Ich glaube, das reicht nicht. Es gibt mittlerweile keinen Goldrausch mehr in den deutschen Unternehmen, in der deutschen Wirtschaft. Es ist mittlerweile fast in allen Ländern gleich, weil die Finanzierung nicht mehr funktioniert. Aber es gibt wahnsinnig viele Leute, die in den Iran reisen und sich die Szenerie anschauen. Sehr viele Wirtschaftsdelegationen. Ich weiß jetzt die Zahl nicht, aber es sind mindestens 10 deutsche Wirtschaftsminister. Wir haben von allem in Deutschland immer 17 Mal. Aber mindestens 10, also 16 an der State Level und ein Bundesminister. Es sind mindestens 10 deutsche Wirtschaftsminister in den Iran gereist die letzten 12 Monate. Ich finde das nicht falsch. Ich finde es nur falsch, wenn auf beiden Seiten Erwartungen geschürt werden, die nicht funktionieren. Und eine Erwartung zum Beispiel zum Thema Wirtschaft ist, dass es dort klare Rechtsfreiheiten gibt oder Rechtsverlässlichkeit gibt. Die gibt es manchmal nicht. Sie kommen in den iranischen Markt zum Beispiel als Unternehmer nicht rein, ohne ein Joint Venture mit einem Iraner, der den Markt für die sondiert, der auch Dinge tun kann, die sie rechtlich nicht dürfen. Zum Beispiel ein Grundstück kaufen und eine Fabrik draufstellen. Das Problem ist nur, dass in der Geschichte der letzten Jahre es häufig so war, dass wenn einer so ein Joint Venture als Iraner eingegangen ist und Erfolg hatte, er plötzlich enteignet werden konnte. Das hat sich nicht geändert. Das führt mich zum Kern dessen, was, glaube ich, für den für den Wandel zentral ist. Aus meiner Sicht ist es die Frage der wirtschaftlichen Struktur des Landes, wie dort vor allem die staatliche Seite arbeitet. Es gibt in der iranischen Verfassung eindeutige Bereiche, die privatisiert werden müssen, die nicht in staatlicher Hand sein sollen. Das klingt erstmal fürchterlich neoliberal, ist es nicht in allen Stellen. Da haben wir einen Dissens. Aber es ist offenkundig, dass es Bereiche gibt, bei denen zumindest Rouhani, dessen Fan man, finde ich, nicht sein kann, wenn man sich allein die Zahl der Exekutionen anschaut, die in den letzten 4 Jahren im Übrigen höher sind als in den Jahren unter Ahmadinejad, das ist offenkundig, dass er Bereiche angeht, die tatsächlich wirklich einen Wandel mit sich bringen können. Er spricht nämlich zum Beispiel davon, dass die Revolutionswächter, also diese parallele Sicherheitsapparatur, die aber die großen Mächtigen im Land sind, dass sie doch eigentlich nur dazu sein sollten, das Land zu verteidigen und nicht als Wirtschaftsunternehmer. Das ist illusorisch erstmal, aber es ist unvorstellbar gewesen vor ein paar Jahren, dass ein Präsident das anspricht. Und allein die Tatsache, dass es eine Gesetzesvorlage gibt, die sicher nicht das Licht der Welt erblicken wird, zumindest nicht bald, in dem drinsteht, wenn Sie schon Wirtschaftsunternehmer sind, sollen Sie auch Steuern zahlen, ist schon beeindruckend. Das ist schon etwas, was tatsächlich ein Stückchen nach vorne gebracht hat. Aber im Kern muss man eine Sache nicht vergessen. Erstens keine Illusion, zweitens ernüchtern, drittens schauen, dass man nicht auf diese ganzen Propagandasprüche auch einfällt und auch nicht auf die Dynamik der Gespräche, die es so nicht geben wird. Aber wir reden über eine Gesellschaft, die nicht nur im regionalen Vergleich, sondern wirklich auch absolut so bereit ist für Wandel durch Annäherung wie kaum eine andere. Und das sind unsere Alliierten, das sind die besten Verbündeten, die wir haben können. Allein deswegen ist es zentral, dass wir die Frage der Menschenrechte nicht hinten runterfallen lassen und denen nicht das Gefühl geben, wir haben den Aktendeckel beschlossen beim Atomprogramm, jetzt habt ihr euch vergessen.
Thank you, Omid, for actually talking about the topic of tonight's discussion. But we're gonna, we're gonna address those issues. So what I'm going to do now, I'm gonna challenge actually, because we have heard, some conflicting narratives, one can say perhaps. And so let me start, ask Hadi, how do you explain the rise of executions under President Rouhani? Because basically, you do have two conflicting narratives when it comes to, the very political structure of the Islamic Republic of Iran. One is that there are different factions who are engaging in a factional infighting in day-to-day politics. And there is a lot of, fights, and this is what we are witnessing, throughout the media, and this is a reflection of the pluralism, of the political pluralism that somehow exists. The second process is somehow, well, there are different factions, but after all, we do have an exclusively Islamist political faction. And within that spectrum, we do have reformists all the way, through, conservatives and to fundamentalist factions. And all of them are actually quite interested in regime survival because they know that they're both benefiting economically and politically from the survival of the regime. So there seems to be two processes at the same time. And in terms of Rouhani and also, Zibo and Omid can also say something. So how would you explain the rise of executions and the political agenda of Rouhani? Because in my eyes, there seems to be a lot of illusions associated with someone who can be called Mr. Established, Mr. Security.
The thing to understand here is that we cannot directly blame or implicate Rouhani or his administration for the rise in executions. They actually don't have any decision-making power in that process. That's completely controlled by the judiciary, who in Ziba's terminology is the Islamic theological part of the regime. And Rouhani doesn't get to appoint any judges or have any saying with how the head of the judiciary decides. However, as you mentioned, he does come from deep intelligence security background within the regime. He does have the presidential bully pulpit. He could have tried to impact the trend of executions. And that's where I blame him. He's done nothing of substance to counter the rise of executions. At the same time, the judiciary and the hardliners know very well the sensitivities that the number of executions in Iran raise on the international level. They know how much that shows, that's a demonstration of their power. I think they actually increased the executions under Rouhani to give us a message out here that they are in charge. Don't get too excited. Rouhani is not capable of doing much. He's all talk, and we're going to give him the diplomatic front on the nuclear negotiations, but we are still in charge inside the country. At least that's the message I've got from the rise in executions. Those executions are really not needed. Over 80% of them target supposedly drug trafficking violations. And the people who are targeted are the most vulnerable segments of the Iranian society. That means the poor, the unemployed, the uneducated. We never, ever, throughout all these years, have seen a figure comparable, let's say, in a country like Colombia, where drug czars were at some point becoming very powerful, and the state went after them, let's say Pablo Escobar, if that name rings a bell, or any other drug czar in Mexico today. So I have never seen an individual prosecuted and executed at that level within the Iran judiciary system. They are all small-time dealers. They're the ones who cannot buy themselves through bribery in the system. They don't have any influence. They're not even, most of them, educated to understand the kind of legal processes against them. So that amazes me that every year the regime is executing 800 to 1,000 of these people in the name of confronting the drug epidemic in Iran, which is a real epidemic. Iran has over 2 million heroin users. Opium, again, is a major problem. There is no question that there is a drug problem in Iran, but this trend of executions, which really accelerated over the past 15 years, has done nothing to it. But when European officials talk to head of Iranian judiciary or others, they say Europe should thank us. We are here fighting the battle for you at the border of Afghanistan to keep these drugs out. But there's absolutely no indication that is it is dampening the volume of drugs traffic. It is reducing drug consumption in the country. There's absolutely no evidence. So these executions are really showing the judiciary's muscle. And no amount of domestic or international pressure going to push them back. Of course, I do see it very much tied to the political executions of the 1980s, which numbered in the tens of thousands over a decade, first decade of the republic. And somehow, that there's an addiction that that is how we're going to assert ourselves and show the public that we have no shame to use violence to its greatest extent. When I go to a country like Brazil and talk about human rights, even under Lula, which was very close to Ahmadinejad, you know, political prisoners, freedom of press, this and that for them is sort of interest. But the moment you get to capital punishment, much of the world, including non-Western states, are really shocked when they learn how many people get executed and for what in Iran. Or another thing that rarely comes to discussion with regard to executions is the fact that Iran has executed juveniles more than any other country. Since 2000, Iran is responsible for more than 75% of executions of children under 18 who committed a crime. And so in a way, executions to me somehow embedded in the root of the security intelligence control that the Islamic Republic has practiced over 40 years. And it is very important to push back against that, because there is always a chance, like 2009, that this huge number of executions turned political. I know that in summer of 2009, many were arguing within the judicial system that let's repeat what we did back in 1988 or 1980s. Let's put the Green Movement, dozens of them, execute them, that will send a signal. They did manage to do a number, but fortunately it not raised to hundreds or thousands that we had seen before.
Thank you. So may I ask Ziba, do you see Rouhani as someone, I mean, if you look at his political agenda, as someone who is really interested in civil rights and human rights, or is it just a fig leaf because of the pressure that is existing in Iranian civil society. So he has to take up this issue to be elected in the first place. But if you look at his record, and if you look at, you know, for example, at the very first press conference that he gave after he was elected, there was a, you know, very quite a substantive disinterest in anything connected to civil rights, it seemed. So, or would you argue, no, actually he is interested, but maybe he cannot do anything about it?
I don't think that it matters a lot whether he's interested or not. Khatami was very much interested and was not able to do much. It has to do with the structure. The fact is the power of the president is extremely limited. And it has become more and more limited since 2005. And in fact, what happened in 2005 with the election of Ahmadinejad was for the first time in Islamic Republic, the three branches of power, judiciary, parliament, and also government, came into the hand of absolute control of the Ayatollah Khamenei and his faction. So the reformists were put aside entirely from the structure of power. And by that time, you know, they were, but it failed. It failed because in 2009, what happened after the election, because they wanted to, by they, I mean the security authorities, and then the leader came to rely more and more on the Revolutionary Guard, on paramilitary, on militia, on those who are actually, their livelihood depends on the hands out of the state. And they many of them are mercenaries, but that is a limited thing. So Rouhani, I think, was a compromise. And the very fact that people and the green movement in Iran, the civil rights movement, went and voted for the, Rouhani because they understood the political context. They understood the limitations of their own system. And at the same time, it was after Arab Spring, and we know what happened in Syria, what happened in Libya with the regime change. And they had seen for the past 10 years the misery in Iraq. So it is actually a civil society, a nation who makes a choice. And most of the time in our politics, exactly what is happening in the US, is the choice between bad and worse for many people. And the main criteria, the main reason was that to end, to stop a war. And the aim was to get the nuclear agreement. And on that, Rouhani delivered. And I think that is important. And that is the beginning. So I think we need to be realistic about Rouhani, that when you say a president goes and says that the press should have freedom, that is his job to do that, secure that. It is his job, but not in Iran. It is his job, but he hasn't got the means to do that. And it is a peculiar system. And also, what we must not forget, the role of Saudi Arabia and what Saudi Arabia and those Gulf countries have done to the Arab Revolution. Wage a counter-revolution. And also with the new king and the new minister of defense, there is a totally different policy by Saudi Arabia. So rapprochement was desired by Iran, but it could not happen. The context had changed. And the global context is very important. But I believe, and this is my own belief, that the hope lies in Europe. And I'm afraid who provides all these arms for the Saudi Arabia? Look what is happening in Yemen, one of the poorest countries, and constant bombing. So it's a very unfair word. So I think, you know, we need to be realistic about Rouhani, and I really don't know what his intention is. But one thing I know for clear is that whoever becomes president has to be the work for the in the direction of democracy and civil society and rights. This is the demand of people. So even Ahmadinejad, towards the last term of his presidency, he became supporter of women's rights. He became supporter of civil society and everything because, you know, that is the institution that make them.
Thank you. So perhaps let's have a last round and concerning the question because the lead question of tonight before we go to the Q&A session. As also Omid mentioned, there are a lot of fears inside but also outside the country among Iranians that this process of rapprochement that is quite positive in the first place going to end up in some kind of an authoritarian stability paradigm, basically, so that the West is fomenting the same kind of relations with Iran as it did with all the Arab dictatorships throughout the last decades in the region, so that there are going to be good relations between the two states, the West and the Iranian state, but basically Iranian civil society will suffer a lot because the space is going to be reduced, something that also happened, of course, in other countries during such kind of Western relations, for example, in Egypt and elsewhere. So how can we avoid falling into this authoritarian stability trap? You suggested, Omid, that we might go for more sanctions, and I would actually, when you talked, you said perhaps we're going to think about some other human rights-related sanctions. But if you look at most sanctions, you see that most sanctions are actually counterproductive in terms of strengthening, civil society. They're So perhaps we can have a last round. So, and you're going to share your ideas how we can perhaps achieve change through rapprochement. So first Omid, and then perhaps Ziba, and then Hadi, and then we're going to go for your questions.
Darf ich ein paar Sätze zum Vorhergesagten sagen? Ich will nur zwei Anmerkungen machen. Das eine ist die Frage der Drogenbekämpfung. Es gibt schon einen Indikator, dass die Iraner tatsächlich das versuchen bis zu einem gewissen Grad. Und das ist die Zahl der Toten, vor allem in Balochistan. Allerdings gibt es ja Cables, die WikiLeaks mal veröffentlicht hat, als WikiLeaks noch cool war. Und zwar aus der amerikanischen Botschaft in Aserbaidschan. Die sind unbestätigt, aber die sind verheerend, wenn sie stimmen. Dort steht nämlich, dass die Pasdaran selbst sich eingeschaltet haben und Drogen kaufen und verkaufen. Erstens, um Geld zu generieren. Zweitens, um die Routen zu sichern. Drittens aber, um den Preis unten zu halten, damit, weil abhängige Kids gehen nicht auf die Straße und protestieren. Und deshalb ist es richtig, dass es nicht einwandfrei ist, aber es ist genauso auch richtig, dass wir eigentlich ein gemeinsames Interesse in der Frage Drogenbekämpfung mit dem Iran hätten. Das Zweite, was ich noch sagen wollte, ich will da 100% zustimmen, was Frau Dr. Mir Hosseini gesagt hat. Die Frage, kann er nicht oder will er nicht? Ehrlich gesagt ist diese Frage mir in den letzten 5 Jahren in Syrien ausgetrieben worden. Ich war 2000, 2001 immer wieder in Damaskus. Da gab es immer wieder dieselbe Frage. Assad hat doch diese Rede gehalten über den Damaszener Frühling. Aber er liefert nicht, kann er nicht oder will er nicht. Am Ende ist es dann Teheran-Astrologie in unserem Fall. Und entscheidend ist das Ergebnis. Und das Ergebnis ist im Falle von Syrien verheerend und im Falle vom Iran ist es einfach, dass er seine Wahlkampfversprechen in der Frage der Grundrechte und Bürgerrechte nicht einhält. Ich habe nicht gesagt, wir brauchen neue Sanktionen. Das habe ich nicht gesagt. Ich habe nur gesagt, wir sollten lauter darüber reden, dass es Sanktionen wegen der Menschenrechtssituation gibt und nicht immer nur darüber reden, welche Sanktionen aufgehoben worden sind und wie die Implementierung aussieht und wie die Geschäfte finanziert werden sollen. Das ist das Hauptthema gerade in jeder Diskussion. Und wir müssen darüber reden, es gab und es gibt Sanktionen wegen der Menschenrechtssituation im Iran. Die Iraner müssen liefern, damit wir sie aufheben können, aber die liefern zurzeit nicht. Und der Grund, warum wir sie nicht aufheben können, ist, dass die Menschenrechtssituation weiterhin verheerend ist. Also es ging mir nicht darum, dass wir jetzt neue Methoden entwickeln. Aber nochmal unter dem Strich, wenn wir wollen, dass es einen Wandel gibt in der iranischen Gesellschaft nach diesem Abkommen, dann dürfen wir die Menschenrechtsfrage nicht an den Rand drängen, weil das Geschäft jetzt gerade so groß ist oder so groß auszusehen scheint. Es gibt Statements aus Großbritannien, da hat ein gewisser Lord, der schon sehr lange Verbindung hat mit dem Iran. Ich wollte den Namen nicht sagen, jetzt hast du es gesagt. Aber jedenfalls hat er gesagt, der Iran wäre der größte, weltweit größte unerschlossene Markt seit dem Zweiten Weltkrieg. Ökonomisch klingt das zweifelhaft, aber es ist auch, das meine ich mit Goldrausch, dem wir nicht hinterherrennen sollten. Natürlich hat der Iran riesige Potenziale, natürlich gibt es riesige Potenziale auch für ein Geschäft, natürlich würden diese Geschäfte auch im Iran was ändern, aber hey Leute, wir reden über einen Staat, wo die Unternehmer auch aus Deutschland nicht Rechtssicherheit haben unbedingt und bei dem du nicht weißt, was mit deinem Partner vor Ort passiert, wenn er mit dir ökonomischen Erfolg hat. Deshalb gemach, gemach.
Your ideas. I think this microphone should be working, actually. No?
Yes, they all work. No, not really. I have nothing to add after this. Yes, I agree with you. And also, I think perhaps it is a blessing because of this economic and of this legal problem in Iran. No sensible business person is going to invest. So they got to sort things out if they want to invest. And economy is really, really important. And it's interesting and it's very important that, you know, in 2008, when you were talking with the Iranian activists and lawyers, their fear about the nuclear agreement was that human rights would be forgotten. But when Hadi did the research, just before 6 years after that, I think some of those activists, a large majority, said, we want this. We want this. So people change. Yeah. And the condition change. Why? Because...
But they didn't want us to forget the human rights.
Absolutely. They don't want to forget human rights. But they see the economy as giving them an opportunity to open the civil society and change. Because this, without this economy, there is a serious economic crisis in Iran, and the system cannot survive for a long time.
I mean, as I see it, actually, I mean, Rouhani's entire economic policy, economic agenda is also not suitable to address all this socioeconomic malaise in Iran. I mean, we didn't talk about the labor movement, that is one of the three constituent parts traditionally of Iranian civil society. We've talked about the women's rights movement, so there is, of course, the students' rights movement who also face harsh repression in a very Islamized campus, actually. So let me direct the business question because it's so interesting. Basically, the entire idea behind the slogan "Wandel durch Annäherung" is that some kind of economic relations revitalization gonna open up some political space somehow, right? But if you look at the particular political economy in the Islamic Republic of Iran, you see there is a lot of monopolization of political and economic power. And basically, the businesses that are out there, they're mostly associated with the IRGC and the Ayatollah Khamenei, but also to the former elite around Rafsanjani somehow that Rouhani tries to incorporate into the system again. But basically, the bulk of the Iranian population is excluded from participating in any meaningful economic activities. So how can we, as civil society, observers perhaps, monitor this process of economic revitalization and, against the backdrop of that it is not going to help authoritarianism in Iran?
I think indeed the economic revitalization and business interactions between Iran and Europe are going to be the most important factor in determining how both the Islamic Republic evolves and how its relations with the West evolve. Let me look at the different constituencies involved here and say the lens through which they see this situation. First of all is the political class in Iran itself, that we have been saying it is not homogeneous. There are reformists, there are centrists, there are conservatives, and there are ultra-hardliners. And it did come up tonight that they all unite in one issue, and that is the survival of the regime. Actually, if you look at their behavior in the 80s, 90s, 2000, And this decade, we can find common interests where they have rallied to make sure the regime survives. I believe with Rouhani, they have reached a point where they realize lack of economic opportunity and underperforming economy for 40 years now is their biggest challenge, and it's actually the challenge of survival. As the population becomes younger and more educated and has less and less opportunity, they know that modernizing the economy and fulfilling that potential is what is going to give the Islamic Republic its longer term survival. So in a way, that is the lens through which they see it. They want Europe to open up, and I believe people like Khamenei at the very top, and you did mention the China model. He would love to see the China model, where the general public benefits economically and gets busy into material dimension of life rather than the political or social issues. He has, I think, admired the Chinese model, but the political power remains very concentrated, very well focused to where it was before economic opening. They would love to see that. And that is where Europe has to be very conscious not to allow that to happen. Then there is the Iranian population itself. That is indeed very interested to have more integration to global economy so that there is more opportunity. If you're a young person, male or female in Iran, you receive first-rate education even within the universities in the country. Or you come abroad, get great education, come back, but the opportunities available to you are extremely limited. And that is a major cause of frustration for young people in Iran who are not even political. They don't want to talk about politics. They don't want to, but they look at their lives and they say, why is my lot drawn like this? Why are the opportunities to me? And they know the fact that the Iranian economy is isolated is a big part of it. Therefore, they do like, I believe, to see more infusion of ideas, technology, capital, and presence of people from all over in the economic sphere of the country. Then there's the European and business side. You mentioned that a lord in England said that this is the biggest gold rush opportunity since World War II. Well, indeed, in a way, it is, if you just look at it in terms of money and business opportunity. I wouldn't say since World War II. I would say since the fall of Berlin Wall here and the opening of the Eastern Bloc to global economy. Why? Because not just the natural resources, 80 million rich population, extremely highly educated. There is a lot of potential there. And again, that is why European governments got to pay attention to the human rights issue when their businesses go in. Indeed, our own organization, as a human rights organization, we are starting a brand new project on monitoring businesses going to Iran and reaching out to them before they go to Iran and informing them of the situation in there and how their own practices can exasperate an already troubling situation. And we're going to monitor them, track them, and keep them responsible, because they knew if we reach out to them now and inform them, then they cannot say, I didn't know what I was getting into. So to wrap it up, there is interest in this economic revitalization from many different sides of the equation. And the key thing is going to be how Europe is going to proceed. Is it just going to open the gates, flooding the country with new business opportunities without caring how those businesses are carried out? Are they going to be partnering with all the human rights violators? The Iranian economy is controlled by Revolutionary Guards, at least 30-40% of it. Or are they going to use their leverage and push back against Iranian hardliners? They have to understand there is leverage here. There is no reason to rush in. The hardliners also want this economic revitalization because the long-term survival of the regime depends on it, but they have to be pushed back. There has to be no movement till there is modernization of the financial system, the legal system, till there are human rights improvements such as labor relations, labor unions. So that's where the European governments must negotiate and seek these changes before they let in their businesses rush into the country. And that is what I'm most worried about, because what I understand in many foreign ministries now, on the Iran desk or the Middle East section dealing with Iran, there is a real divide. there are a group of people who are saying that, you know, we're competing against each other. Dutch competing with the German, German competing with Italians, Italians with the Spanish. Actually, there is a great disunity on this issue within EU because each country wants to get in first and reap the benefits first. And that's very troubling. That's where we need pressure in Brussels to bring these policies together. But more importantly, we need to make sure that they understand the leverage Europe has. Europe actually, I believe, has the upper hand in this situation because the Americans are absent. They're not, there's still many restrictions for American companies entering. The Chinese and Russians had their run during the sanctions, actually. They did deal with Iran and they expanded a lot of their exports and other relations. But from what I understand, much of the Iranian business community and government, so on, are not very impressed with what they got from Russian and Chinese. And they want to focus on Europe. And Europe got to understand they have the upper hand and they should use that leverage to improve the situation inside the country, or otherwise we will end up with what you're calling authoritarian stability. And I would blame the European governments for that, if that happens.
Zwei Punkte, die Dr. Grahami gerade angesprochen hat, nämlich erstens, zwei Punkte, die er gerade angesprochen hat. Erstens die Frage vom internationalen Austausch, gerade für die Zivilgesellschaft. Zweitens aber auch die Möglichkeit, dass man die Geschäfte nicht zwingend mit den Falschen macht, haben ein Instrument, was ganz schwierig ist zurzeit gerade in der deutschen Politik. Ich weiß, dass es gerade in der Flüchtlingshypnose in unserer Gesellschaft nicht um Vogue ist, als zu sagen, aber die Visapolitik, die manche europäischen Staaten, aber vor allem Deutschland dort gerade fährt, ist desaströs. Und wenn wir wollen, dass es die Austauschmöglichkeiten gibt, müssen wir Leute auch mal ausreisen lassen und hierher kommen lassen. Die deutsche Botschaft hat einen Visavergabetermin gehabt, das kennen viele hier. Das war einfach nur skandalös. Wir haben überall, wo wir konnten, den Versuch, der Regierung zu helfen, damit sie das ändert. Jetzt behaupten sie, dass sie es geändert hätte frisch. Ich habe wirklich eine Bitte. Viele, ich weiß, dass hier Leute sind, die auch Erfahrungen damit gemacht haben oder auch machen oder Bekannte haben. Schreiben Sie uns, lassen Sie uns wissen, wie sich es ändert. Weil so wie es bisher war, dass Leute nämlich eine Stunde die Woche versucht haben, einen Termin zu bekommen. Es hat nicht geklappt und am Ende konnte man das nur über korruptive Wege gehen. Es ist skandalös, wirft ein schlechtes Licht auf Deutschland, aber vor allem verhindert, dass genau diesen Austausch, den Sie beschrieben haben, der zwingend ist und überlebenswichtig ist, eben für die Zivilgesellschaft im Iran.
Thank you. So, where is the mic for the Q&A? Do we have a mic? Okay. Is there somebody with a mic? Oh, sorry. I didn't organize it beforehand, as you see. May I ask, können ich Sie fragen, sich kurz vorzustellen, wenn Sie eine Frage stellen wollen und auch eine Bitte von der Frage stellen können? Kurreferat, wir haben auch nicht mehr so viel Zeit. Eine halbe Stunde ungefähr. So maybe we can collect two or three questions. Now I see people. So the gentleman there, and perhaps a lady somewhere, I don't know. The lady here, and then, so the gentleman, just there, please. I saw you as well. Yeah.
Zimmerman, Quest Media. I have a question about civil society and how it's understood in the way that you're describing it. It seems to, as far as I was able to sort of infer, you really mean liberal, democratic, secular people or groups as your civil society. I don't know much about Iran, but isn't there not also a conservative civil society, a religious civil society, and what is in fact the basis of the regime's support? Can you give me some idea of the demographics of the sort of conservative religious people that are actually presumably the basis of the regime's support as a percentage of the population? And can you characterize that for me? And how are you going to deal with that in light of your preference?
Yeah, thank you. The lady here, please. And then the gentleman over there. Yes.
Ja, hallo, ich bin Teresa. Genau. Ich war im August jetzt kurz im Iran und ich war da eigentlich doch überrascht, wie viele Menschen ich dort getroffen habe, die Tinder und Grindr nutzen. Und weil man hier, ja, wenn man so ein Bild vom Iran hat, ja doch irgendwie hört, dass sehr viele, dass Homosexualität unter Todesstrafe steht und dass eigentlich so ein Leben dort nicht möglich ist. Und deswegen würde mich mal von Ihnen interessieren oder von euch interessieren, wie ihr die Situation von Lesben, Schwulen und Queeren Menschen im Iran beschreiben würdet. Und auch wenn es geht, würde ich gerne mal Zahlen hören, wenn es Todesurteile gab, wie viele das in den letzten Jahren waren.
Danke sehr. Der Monsieur ganz hinten.
And then maybe we can also have a fourth question, actually. So if there is a lady, or a lady, no, sir.
Ja.
Lady, over there, yes.
Mein Name ist Frank Wende. Ich habe ja gehört, dass der Iran auch Beziehungen zu China hat, auf wirtschaftlichem Gebiet. Wie sieht das eigentlich mit der Türkei aus? Hat der Iran auch zur Türkei Beziehungen und was für welche?
Die Dame dort hinten.
Yes, I'm Mariam Kohansal. I'm a PhD student here under TU Urban and Regional Planning, and I'm based in Tehran actually, and I go and come frequently. Actually, I want to add some comments on the people that has mentioned the definition of civil society in your eyes. Because actually I think that you didn't make a difference between the activists and the civil society. What all you have talked about is all about the activists and not the civil society. I think that civil society, it's all of us that try to change in when it's not possible in a formal way, in an informal way. And I didn't see that you mentioned these informal gatherings, NGOs even. We have feminine NGOs there in Iran, women NGOs. And I think that this informal way of living that includes all our tries to have relations with outside Iran and inside Iran societies and people together should be mentioned here. Because if I was a foreigner here and if I was a German people here, I never take a risk to go and visit an Iran with the image that you have created here.
Okay, thank you. So let's first go for quick sessions, and then we're gonna go for a second round. Perhaps Ziba may respond to the question on how to define and conceptualize Iranian civil society between secular and religious. And I might add to that question, I mean, if you look at Iranian political culture, you've basically, you know, three dominant politico-ideological formations. You have nationalism, Islamism, and socialism. But basically, you have had, since the establishment of the Islamic Republic, a harsh repression vis-a-vis any non-Islamist traditions. And how does it reflect, you know, the fights and the debates within the women's movement, perhaps? And perhaps you can say two or three sentences on that as well.
Yes, the big question, two and three sentences. You know, the reality on the ground is much more messy. You know, when we want to talk about it, we try to put them in neat categories, civil society, activists, and this sort of thing. But the fact is that civil society in Iran is not conventional civil society in terms of organizations. But activists, I think, is actually the voice of civil society, certain part of the civil society. So I don't see activists separate from the civil society. It is part of it, but activists actually are those who give somehow a voice at the political level. And I would say that the division between secular and religious has been broken down in Iran. And when I, in fact, the two, what at least what I was talking about, was not about the secular type of civil society. It was actually about the civil society that is moving towards a democratic way, fighting for civil rights and fighting for the democratic rights. And among that is women's rights, of course. But the civil society, the religious civil society exists, but the religious civil society also is moving to the notion of secular. I don't use secular in the sense of not believing in religion, but coming to this understanding that the institution of government, institution of state, must be separate from religion. Because once you have religion, mix with state, you will have only one ideology. And Iranians have lived over 37 years now under an Islamic Republic. So it has been actually a learning process. It has secularized the society from below in that sense. But it didn't make them non-religious. Of course, there are groups who have become totally anti-religious, but they define their religiosity in a different way. And that is actually important in it is going that. The same thing is happening among the women's movement. I would say until 2000, definitely until 2005, 2006, the women's movement in Iran was divided, very much divided around the secular line and the religious line. But now that division is no longer there. There are people who are hardliners, or I call them fundamentalist secularists. And there are people who are fundamentalist religious, and they are really ideological on their stance. And Iranian society is moving towards a non-ideological. And of course, when I say Iranian society, I am generalizing. There are different factions. We can talk about rural Iran. We can talk about urban, northern part of Tehran, affluent part of Tehran. But the structure of society has changed. You know, statistics tells us. Out of 80%, 80 million population, over 60% are under 35. So it is very young. And the age of marriage has raised. It's a society that is changing in structure of family and gender relations. And I would say that in a way, you know, we have many Iranian men who have become gender aware. And the Islamic Republic itself has been a hard course for gender awareness. Because from whatever women did, from the very beginning of the revolution, what they dressed, how they studied, whatever they did became a political matter. And it really made the personal political. And also the young generation of Iranian men who are not among the Islamic brothers came to experience a similar kind of oppression by the authority and regime. And that raised a consciousness. And I think this is important, that what is happening, because I don't think that we can have a democratic society without an egalitarian gender basis. And the basis of it is in the family and gender relations. And this is moving. This is moving. So I don't know whether I answered your question or your question. Yes, there are religious people, but they are also democratic. They are also writing, have civil rights aspirations. And I do not believe in this line between secular and religious. It depends what kind of religious. Who speaks in the name of religions? And who speaks in the name of secularism? We can have despotism in a secular guise. We can have despotism in a religious guise. So I think we need to think out of the box of these conventional categories when we come to Iran.
Thank you, Ziba. Perhaps Hadi can respond to the question about the situation of LGBT in Iran.
I will, but before going there, I want to just re-emphasize what Ziba just said about secular versus religious in Iran. Because it is one issue that makes me very optimistic about the future. And that's what she said. The majority of the Iranian population from bottom up after 40 years of Islamic Republic is secular. Not because they don't have religious beliefs anymore or somehow they become godless. No, they have kept to their personal beliefs, but the majority has come to the conclusion that separation of state and religion is essential. And the way it has been has come together under Islamic Republic does not work. People do want to see separation of church and state. And that is really a hopeful sign for me, even though it doesn't come into action much. But in the long term, when this generation matures, it will. And before getting to your question about frightening people to going to Iran, I definitely hope that we did not give that impression. We're talking about political, social structures that have to withstand government pressure, and we have to be honest about those pressures being exerted. I'm very well aware of all the non-conventional ways people are coming together, even taking action. I mentioned some of them in terms of social networking. And indeed, I tell all my American friends to get up, go visit Iran right now, and how surprised they would be in their experience, because we're making a distinction between people and the state. The people, the society has evolved very, very differently than the practices of government, which we're discussing tonight. And an example of it is the LGBTQ community that I've also tracked for the last two decades. And in law, homosexual conduct is criminalized in Iran. It can raise to the level of execution on paper in law. In practice, like any other society, there is LGBTQ community. And you cannot deny it. And actually, since 2000, well, you cannot deny the, you can say it verbally, but in practice, that is going to go on like any other society. And in Iran, it is going on. You mentioned your own, you know, observation of it. And I'm glad to say that, again, the young new generation has come, it has been a cultural taboo. When I grew up as a young boy in Iran, definitely discussion of such and such a person being gay or lesbian was very demeaning, defaming, and, you know, the message given to me as a young boy was that, you know, by no means such a conduct should be condoned. But today, I believe within families, within smaller structures of society, people have come to accept it. They have come to recognize that there is a portion of every population where this exists. And I'm very glad to see that actually under Ahmadinejad, organized LGBT communities and activists came together and organized during Ahmadinejad era. There is a Canadian Broadcasting Corporation documentary where the guy goes to Tehran in 2007 and meets these people and goes around with them. And, you know, they are putting together health campaigns, awareness campaigns on the issues for their community. And again, internet allowed them to organize and coordinate. Unfortunately, many pioneers of that movement, again, have been pushed into exile, but they are from outside Iran still organizing and communicating with their communities in Iran. So a cultural taboo has been lifted. With regard to executions, we definitely have had such executions over the 40 years, but for the past two decades where I've been tracking it, there are a couple of very highly publicized cases that in the early 2000s took place. But I cannot say if it is happening or not, because the judiciary is being very opaque. And we believe there are cases, but the crime that's assigned to them seems to always be another crime in order to hide it. So I have no ability to give you statistics or how widespread it is, but I can tell you that the LGBT community in Iran has grown in terms of overcoming a cultural taboo, organizing itself, and communicating among themselves.
Thank you. Omid, you want to?
Ganz kurz zu erstmal zur Frage LGBTQ. Es wird aber am Ende von den relevanten Kräften doch geleugnet, was völlig irre ist. Aber das bringt mich zu dem, ich habe keine Zahlen, das ist alles so deutlich akkurater, als ich sagen könnte. Ich sage das, weil Sie die Imagefrage hier angesprochen haben, was wir hier für ein Image vom Iran wiedergeben. Ich kann nur wiederholen, wenn Sie die Möglichkeiten dahin haben, dahin zu fahren, fahren Sie. Fahren Sie vielleicht nicht im Mai, im Juni, da ist Wahlkampf, da gibt es bestimmte Unsicherheiten, vor allem für Doppelstaatler. Aber fahren Sie dahin, machen Sie sich ein eigenes Bild, tauschen Sie sich aus, ermutigen Sie die Menschen im Iran, die sich sehr darauf freuen, auch diese Besuche zu empfangen. Aber ehrlich gesagt, es gibt einen unglaublichen Mut in der Zivilgesellschaft. Ich meine Zivilgesellschaft, nicht Aktivistinnen und Aktivisten. Die Tatsache, dass zum Beispiel Iranerinnen, die lange im Ausland gelebt haben, zurückgehen und erstmal feststellen müssen, dass die Iranerinnen selbst ihr Kopftuch etwa 25 Zentimeter weiter hinten tragen, als sie es gerade gemacht haben, zeigt auch, was für einen Mut es da gibt. Aber dieser Mut ist über die Leute. Am Ende des Tages ist die Frage, wie ist die Menschenrechtssituation? Und da rede ich natürlich auch gerne über diese unglaublich vielen mutigen Iranerinnen und Iranern. Aber entscheidend tut sich die Menschenrechtsfrage anhand derer, bei denen es schief geht. Die belangt werden, weil die Gesetze so sind, wie sie sind, weil im Gesetz steht, dass deswegen Homosexualität die Leute exekutiert werden, auch wenn es viele Leute gibt, die mit unglaublichem Mut ihr Leben leben und sich nicht davon unterkriegen lassen. Aber es ist keine Imagefrage, das ist eine Frage der Rechtsetzung im Iran. Und wenn wir nicht drüber reden, glaube ich, dass wir den Leuten keinen Gefallen tun. Das Zweite ist, wer ist Zivilgesellschaft? Und um die Frage säkular, ich traue mich nicht zu sagen, wie die Mehrheitsverhältnisse sind, nicht nur im Iran nicht. Es ist mittlerweile so, dass ja jeder, der ein Anliegen hat, aufsteht und sagt, ich bin das Volk. Deshalb tue ich mir jetzt gerade schwer zu sagen, wie die Mehrheiten sind im Land, in dem es ja keine breiten, unabhängigen Demoskopenarbeit gibt. Aber es ist offenkundig, in der Islamischen Republik ist die Jugend säkularer als in der laizistischen Republik Türkei. Wahrscheinlich gibt es ein ähnliches Verhältnis auch zwischen der Jugend nach 10 Jahren oder länger Hamas-Herrschaft, zwischen der Jugend in Gaza und der Jugend in der Westbank, glaube ich auch, dass die Immunisierung in Gaza doch mittlerweile größer ist. Aber natürlich sind auch religiöse Leute Zivilgesellschaft oder auch Aktivisten. Ich will einen Fall nehmen, das ist Groß-Ayatollah Kazım Burujerdi. Dieser Mann ist Quittist, der hat stets die Stimme erhoben gegen die Herrschaft des Rechtsgelehrten, was ja auch Tradition ist in der schiitischen Geistlichkeit. Und sagt grundsätzlich bis heute, wenn er denn überhaupt zum Sprechen kommt, dass Religion und Staat massiv getrennt gehören voneinander. Der ist entmantelt worden, was es so noch nicht gegeben hat in der Geschichte der Schia. Die haben ihm die Groß-Ayatollah-Würde abgenommen, was eigentlich nicht vorgesehen ist. Der steckt im Knast und ist schwer krank. Und wird noch ein bisschen sitzen, wie es aussieht. Das ist ein Mensch, der ist Aktivist, Zivilgesellschaftler und Groß-Ayatollah. So wie viele andere Groß-Ayatollahs ja auch dieses grundsätzliche Konzept, was ja die Herrschaft des Landes ja determiniert, auch ablehnen. Der hochrangigste Groß-Ayatollah wahrscheinlich der Welt ist Sistani, iranischstämmiger Groß-Ayatollah in Najaf, der lehnt die Herrschaft des Rechtsgelehrten aus theologischen Gründen auch ab. Und deshalb finde ich diese Grenze zwischen, wie es gerade gesagt worden ist, nicht so leicht zu ziehen. Das Letzte, damit die Frage nicht untergeht, wie ist das Verhältnis zur Türkei? Ja, es gibt viel Handel, zunehmend. Es gibt ja 3 Regionalmächte, Türkei, Iran und Saudi-Arabien, wie es immer so schön heißt. Sie haben große Konflikte miteinander. Iran, Saudi-Arabien kriegen das nicht, einen Modus Vivendi zu finden, was verheerend ist für die ganze Region. Saudi-Arabien und Türkei kriegen das hin. Die haben riesigen Streit in der Frage Ägypten zum Beispiel und trotzdem haben sie ein Verhältnis gefunden und Iran-Türkei auch. Das Verhältnis Iran-Türkei ist in der Frage Ägypten einheitlich. Die sind sich beide einig, dass sie Sisi bekämpfen und die Muslimbrüder eigentlich richtig fanden. Aber im Irak und im Irak vielleicht sogar noch mehr als in Syrien haben sie riesige Auseinandersetzungen. Die bekämpfen sich indirekt auf dem Battlefield. Und am Ende des Tages haben sie aber kein Problem, einander zu empfangen, sich zu umarmen, zu sagen, wir sind Brüder. Und das ist halt eine Art von Außenpolitik, an die wir uns, fürchte ich, mächtig gewöhnen werden müssen, die wir der Meinung sind, dass auch sowas wie Werte dazugehört. Das war mal Außenpolitik.
Um vielleicht mal die Türkei-Frage auf die Zivilgesellschaft zu runterzubrechen, vielleicht haben wir so eine Annäherung an iranische Verhältnisse in der Türkei so gerade.
So we're gonna have a last round, and please keep it very short because we basically have maximum 5 minutes actually. So there was this gentleman with the glasses. Are we spending the entire night here together, or like till dawn, till we celebrate Trump? Yeah, no, just kidding. So the gentleman with the glasses, the lady here in front, the gentleman over there. So 1, 2, 3, please. Okay.
Ja,
ich
bin Kian, ich bin Student an der FU und ich habe eine Frage bezüglich der, es wurde gesagt, wir sollen den Iran jetzt nicht als wir sollen nicht dem Goldrausch verfallen, wenn es jetzt um Wirtschaftsinvestitionen geht, um Wirtschaftsdelegierte, die jetzt in den Iran einfallen und mit den Hufen glauben, weil die Menschenrechtslage eben so schwierig ist, dass man das auch bedenken muss und dass wir da unsere Wirtschaftsmacht als Europäer auch als Hebel und als Druckmittel nutzen können. Ich finde das als Bürger immer so ein bisschen schwierig, das nicht als heuchlerisch abzutun, wenn man bedenkt, dass einer der größten Wirtschaftspartner in der Region Saudi-Arabien ist und da wir eben auch diese schwerwiegenden Menschenrechtsprobleme haben und da scheinbar es kein Problem ist, da ein Auge zuzudrücken, weil eben das Geschäft so gut läuft mit den Panzern und den Munitionen. Und deswegen, also ich würde verstehen, wenn man sagt, okay, das innere Wirtschaftssystem im Iran ist vielleicht unattraktiv für unsere Unternehmen und dass wir dann deswegen sagen, okay gut, dann lassen wir es lieber. Aber dann diese Menschenrechtsfrage vorzuschieben, es fällt mir schwer, das nicht als heuchlerisch abzutun. Und ich würde gerne da vielleicht von Ihnen wissen, was Sie dazu sagen.
Danke sehr. Die Dame hier vorne.
Dankeschön. Lisa, Journalismus als Hintergrund. Es wurde vorhin zweimal erwähnt, dass sich seit dem Atomabkommen die Nachbarschaftspolitik oder wurde sehr viel aggressiver vom Iran. Und meine Frage ist, ob die Annäherung an den Westen heißt, dass es eine Abkehr von den Nachbarn gibt oder was eigentlich die Gründe sind, warum das so viel aggressiver geworden ist.
Dankeschön, aber genau, aber versuchen wir auf Zivilgesellschaft vielleicht uns zu konzentrieren, aber ist auch ein sehr wichtiges Thema. Der Herr dort hinten mit dem roten Pulli.
Thank you very much. My question
is briefly introduce yourself, please.
My name is Ali Reza Labeshka. I'm curator based in Berlin. My question is for Hadi Ghaemi and regarding the topic he raised about the importance of concerning human rights condition of Iranian institute that the Western companies want to cooperate with, and the importance of, you know, informing them what is the situation of human rights in Iran, and to avoid them to cooperate with the institute that have some problems. My question is about the history of Western countries dealing with countries like Qatar, Emirates, Saudi Arabia. Was it successful? The human rights were success. Human rights institute like your institute were successful to stop cooperating the corporations of Western countries with this kind of countries, which, you know, it seems, I don't know, you know better than me, the situation of human rights in these countries, that you are asking them or you want to stop them to cooperate with these institutes in Iran again.
Okay, thank you. So potentially one last question and then we're going to have a last round. Nobody? No one? Yes, please. Sorry, I didn't see you guys actually. So two ladies at the end. So first you, please, and over there.
Karina Günther aus Berlin. Mich würde interessieren, wie Sie nächstes Jahr die Wahlen, die jetzt schon mehrmals erwähnt wurden, wie die sich möglicherweise auch auf die Entwicklung auswirken können. Ist das ja einfach nur eine Farce oder wird sich da vielleicht möglicherweise auch etwas tun, weil ja im Februar bereits die Parlamentswahlen doch anders ausgefallen sind als erwartet.
Danke sehr. Letzte Frage bitte, hinten. Die Dame dort hinten. Da drüben, genau.
Hi, I'm Armaron, a jurist from Berlin. I would like to know your stance on the current revelations of Montazeri's audio files in early spring, and if you think it might have an impact on, I don't know, public international law even, or civil society in general.
Thank you so much for your fascinating question. So whoever feels that he or she has to respond to a certain question, please feel free to do so. Perhaps, shall we start again, and then Hadi, Ziba, or who wants to step in first?
Okay, so I start with Hadi. Okay.
I'll try to remember the questions. Probably I'll start with the last question since I remember it very well. It does require a little bit of background here, and indeed it is a very important topic to be brought up because it goes back to 1988 to an event that I call the most horrific massacre in contemporary Iranian history, basically since 19th century, since 1850 or maybe even earlier. I cannot think of a single event in Iran that raised to this level of atrocity and crime against humanity. I'll be very quick. What happened? We had thousands of political prisoners who were serving their sentences in Iranian jails. Many of them were due to be freed. They just had prison sentences. Many were young people, teenagers who were in jail in the from early 80s for selling opposition newspaper, so on. And a decision was made to kill them all. Of the range of 5,000 to 6,000 prisoners minimum that we can document and know were put to death in a matter of 3 weeks. And the regime has been trying to hide that atrocity by never, ever acknowledging it and always saying this is a lie propagated by our enemies. What happened at the time that we do know for sure, Khomeini was at the end of his life, the last year of his life. He did have an apparent heir by the name Ayatollah Montazeri that Armaghan mentioned. And Montazeri was very well aware of what was happening during those 3 weeks. So he raised his objections at the time, and it reached a level where he was pushed aside. He actually was completely isolated, put under house arrest, and this was the person who was about to become the supreme leader within a year of that event. He was put under house arrest. He never had any communication in public. Till early 2000, he managed to publish his memoir online. And in it, he documents the meetings he has with the judiciary, judges, and people who were carrying out this atrocity, objecting to it, asking them to stop, saying this is non-Islamic. There is no rationale to kill so many people who already have been tried. Really, the horrific part was that these people already been through an unfair system of justice. And now suddenly they were all given execution sentences. So we kind of know that he objected and what level through his memoirs published online in 2000. But what happened this summer was truly, truly unprecedented. His son published an audio tape of the meeting he had with the three leading perpetrators of the crime. Three people who are still very much within the regime. One of them is Minister of Justice. One of them is one of the highest judges in the Supreme Court. And one of them was just handed down the biggest business economy empire of a Shiite shrine in Iran to lead that. So these three people are still very much matter, and it's a meeting between Mortazavi and these three people discussing details of the killings and why he objects to it. And it is very important because one day there will be accountability. One day there will be a trial of some sort to address this killing, which is really, for me, it's almost like what Holocaust is to the Jews. It is a matter of never again. We have to confront this atrocity and hold accountable people who carried out. And I really commend Mortazavi's son for bringing that audio tape into the public eye. Now is probably the biggest evidence we have for any kind of prosecution. It may not be a material prosecution. It may be at least a generation removed from now. But for a matter of history and the public consciousness to reach the never again point, this was a very important document. And it is the most significant piece of evidence we have of that crime against humanity.
Thank you, Pap. So since we're running out of time, may I ask Ziba to share us her final thoughts, and then Omid. There were actually a few questions on like Iranian regional geopolitics, on the role on Western relations, or you know the topic of Western arms exports towards GCC states. But you know, please forgive us if we cannot respond because it's we are running short of time, and then it's also not within you know the core of the topic tonight. But Ziba, please.
Yes, I don't think that Iranian government or Iranian regime has become aggressive after the nuclear deal. It is actually the Saudi Arabia and Qatar have, or the other states in the region who are so frightened. Because that sanctions served them. And also Israel, the role that Israel plays in on that, and it's, so it is really I see it as naive thinking that it is only Iran has become aggressive. I think Iran has become more defensive because it's a question of its survival, and for Iran it's very important to have the Hezbollah. And Hezbollah is the only force that can stand to Israel, and the arm and everything for Hezbollah has got to go through Syria. So that is the strategic interest there. So it is really much more complex than that. And I also think that it is not possible to compare Iran with Saudi Arabia and Qatar or any country in that region, Arab country in that region, because Iranian society is really a different one. Iran has experienced two revolutions in the course of 20th century, and both revolutions were for independence, rule of law, and independent judiciary and democracy. It has not succeeded. The first one ended in a secular dictatorship, the second one in a religious dictatorship. But the Iranian society has changed and developed, and we keep on stressing the Iranian society has changed because the change needs to come from inside. And you don't have that in Saudi Arabia. And therefore, deals with Iran or opening the economy, improvement of the economy in Iran, I see it as a key. And I don't, and I see the role of human rights organizations outside Iran is very important. But at the same time, I think that when it comes to the deals, all governments forget about human rights. It is the duty of people from inside to argue for it. We cannot expect that European or foreign countries defend Iranian's human rights. It is the job of Iranian themselves. And they are doing it. And the only thing that they are asking is that please do not interfere, as you did, not you, of course, Americans did in 1952 with the coup for Mossadegh. And then war with Iraq, invasion of Iran. And now, you know, this is the whole thing. And if this threat of regime change is taken away, I think the Iranian regime would have no more excuse of blaming everything for outside powers and things like this. So I think that is important. Next year's election is important. As this election in November this year was extremely important because it ended the absolute control of the hardliners in the parliament, and the number of women deputies doubled there, and the reformists with all their restriction, with all this vetoing and disqualifying. The reformist and centrist, Rouhani's alliance, I think they have the majority. And that is important. And we see what happens next year. And I see it actually as moving from one stage to another. And in the process, both the elites are learning and becoming more divided, and some of them have become really democratic. I would say that somebody like Ayatollah Rafsanjani has changed his position, and he has been consistent since 2009. And the doors around them, and so we see the change in the political elite as well as in society. I end on this.
Thank you so much. So Omid has the privilege of his home turf, the last word.
Das
Words,
ist,
but not too many, please.
Das ist nicht fair, weil nach 130 Minuten kommt jetzt eine richtige Kontroverse hoch und ich habe das Schlusswort. Ich versuch's mal trotzdem. Goldrausch versus Rüstungsexporte nach Saudi-Arabien, das ist doch Heuchelei. Stimmt. Deshalb bin ich gegen Rüstungsexporte nach Saudi-Arabien. Und was die in Jemen machen, ist im Übrigen Grund, finde ich, auch bereits erteilte Genehmigung zu widerrufen, weil die Bomben gerade das ärmste Land der Arabischen Liga in die Steinzeit ohne Sinn und Verstand, und das ist alles einfach nur unfassbar unerträglich. Und deshalb stimmt. Also, aber es geht nicht darum, jetzt sozusagen Gleichheit im Unrecht herzustellen. Es geht aber darum, dass wir das Unrecht auf beiden Seiten eben angehen müssen. Die zu Montazeri, ich bin mit allem, was gesagt worden ist, einverstanden, bis auf den historischen Vergleich, aber es ist richtig, dass das ein einschneidendes Erlebnis war in die Geschichte des Irans und auch in viele, viele Familienbiografien. Sehr, sehr vieles kann man sich kaum vorstellen. Ich will nur noch zu den letzten beiden Themen Wahlen und Regionalpolitik. Ich glaube, es gibt zwei Gründe für die deutlich aggressivere Regionalpolitik. Jetzt weiß ich gerade nicht mehr, wer die Frage gestellt hat. Für die deutlich aggressivere. Das eine ist, nach dem Atomdeal ist mehr Geld da, also geht das auch. Das zweite ist, nach dem Atomdeal gilt es ja auch, diejenigen im System, die gegen das Abkommen waren, auch zu beruhigen. Und dementsprechend gibt es auch mehr Freiheiten, zum Beispiel für Milizen und so weiter und so fort. Womit ich ganz sicher nicht einverstanden bin, dass das, was der Iran macht, dort defensiv ist. Israel macht ganz vieles, was ich hart kritisiere, täglich. Aber kein Staatsoberhaupt Israels hat jemals gesagt, wir werden den Iran im Übrigen demnächst zerstören. Und ja, es gibt große Gefahren auch für die Sicherheit Iran, zum Beispiel in Syrien. Aber ein Land, das sich zwei Länder weiter verteidigt, das nenne ich Imperialismus. Und es gibt viele, viele, viele Beispiele dafür, wie zum Beispiel Leute gesagt haben, wenn ich jetzt nicht preemptiv eingegriffen hätte, dann hätten die mich angegriffen. Das tut mir leid, ich komm damit nicht klar. Und das Letzte ist die Wahlen. Das ist eine super gute Frage. Ehrlich gesagt, es steht so, dass fast immer, wenn ich irgendwie was gesagt habe, wie es da weitergeht, es schiefgegangen ist, weil man es nicht weiß. Ich glaube, dass es ein Grundkonzept gibt, tatsächlich in der Hand der Revolutionsführung in erster Linie die Innereien des Systems auszubalancieren. Das würde zum jetzigen Zeitpunkt für mich sprechen, dass Rouhani 4 weitere Jahre darf. Aber ehrlich gesagt, ich hätte nie gedacht, dass er darf, also vor 4 Jahren. Deshalb, ich habe keinen blassen Schimmer. Aber richtig ist, dass sehr vieles, was wir heute Abend diskutiert haben, tatsächlich auch daran hängt, wer Präsident wird. Weil unabhängig davon, wie ohnmächtig es ist, da bin ich wieder hundertprozentig bei Ihnen, es ist am Ende des Tages so, dass er unglaublich viel ausstrahlt nach außen. Und diese Ausstrahlung ist etwas, was immer wieder für unsere Arbeit von Relevanz ist, im Guten wie im Schlechten.
Herzlichen Dank. Danke sehr. So I think we've had quite an interesting event, if you agree or don't agree with me. I thought thank you so much for attending. Thank you so much for Ziba from and Hadi for coming to Berlin. And as you all see, this is one of the most tricky questions that we all have to be quite vigilant about and be observing how this process is going on, because we don't want to fall into the traps of that we had in terms of relations with some other countries in the region for the last 40 years that culminated in the so-called Arab Spring. Ich wünsche Ihnen allen noch einen schönen Wahlabend. Gute Nacht.